Welcome, friends, to this follow-up day after Bhandara, the day of evaluation, the day of reckoning, or boast. I was intoxicated yesterday, and my intoxication still continues today. How many of you felt intoxicated yesterday, and how many of you feel the intoxication still continuing today? I'm very happy to see that. How many of you felt that your coming to this Bhandara was rewarding and you got what you expected? I'm very happy. Yes. That's a good success rate. Somebody complained to me yesterday that I am getting more and more serious as time goes on. And where has my sense of humor gone away? That I limit myself to one or two jokes in the entire talk? That was not my style in the good old days. So I decided that today I'll share a few more jokes with you. You must have noticed I never use any notes for my talks, my conversations with you. I've never used any notes. But today I want to use some because I can't remember all the nice jokes. So if you would permit me, I'll use my notes today to read out a few jokes for you. And I hope that you won't mind if the jokes relate to religion, because I have always been saying that religion has departed from spirituality. And some of these reveal how we have departed from spirituality. So with your permission, I'm going to pull out my iPhone for my notes. Here's the first one. Who is a true Christian? A man was walking across a bridge one day, and I saw a man standing on the edge. That man walking says this. I saw a man standing on the edge, about to jump off. I immediately ran over and said, "Stop, don't do it." "Why shouldn't I?" he said. I said, "Well, there is so much to live for." He said, "Like what?" "Well, are you religious or atheist?" "Religious." "Me too." "Are you Christian or Jewish?" "Christian." "Me too." "Are you Catholic or Protestant?" "Protestant." "Me too." "Are you Episcopalian or Baptist?" "Baptist." "Wow, me too. Are you Baptist Church of God or Baptist Church of the Lord?" "Baptist Church of God." "Me too. Are you original Baptist Church of God or are you Reformed Baptist Church of God?" "Reformed Baptist Church of God." "Me too. Are you Reformed Baptist Church of God, Reformation of 1879? Or Reformed Baptist Church of God, Reformation of 1915? "Reformed Baptist Church of God, Reformation 1915. To which I said, "Die, heretic," and I pushed him down. How can believers in the same Christ, in the same Lord, create such divisions through denominations? It's really amazing. The young man, this is about a new pastor. Some pastors are very nervous in the beginning, and some are experts old, they've been giving their sermons for a long time. Now I'm going to read you the story of a new pastor. The young man had just graduated from Bible college and was called to pastor a church close to his hometown. The new pastor was so nervous at his first service, he could hardly speak. Before his second appearance in the pulpit, he asked his former pastor how he could relax during his sermons. The older minister said, "Next Sunday, it may help you if you put a little vodka in your water. After a few sips, everything should go smoothly. And I will be visiting the church next week to see how things go for you." The next Sunday, the young minister put the suggestion into practice. and was able to talk up a storm. He felt great. However, after the service, his former pastor pulled him aside and offered him this advice. Number one, next time, sip rather than gulp. Second, there are 10 commandments, not 12. And there are 12 disciples, not 10. We do not refer to the cross as the big T. I should not be laughing myself. The recommended grace before meals is not rubber-dubber-dub, thanks for the grub. We do not refer to our Savior, Jesus, and his disciples as JC and the boys. Okay, let me try to finish it, if I can. Last two items. Seventh, David slew Goliath. He did not kick the crap out of him. I'm laughing at the next one. Okay. Let me get a little sober. Last but not the least, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are never referred to as Big Daddy, Junior, and the Spook. I hope I haven't. I sometimes wonder how people cry when they are sad, and I cry at jokes. The former Pope, the German Pope, was used to driving Mercedes-Benz on the highways called Autobahns in Germany. And suddenly he comes to the Vatican, he's never allowed to drive there. He got a big limousine, chauffeur-driven limousine. So one day he was in his limousine traveling outside the Vatican. And he decided that nobody knew that was a good time to get back at the wheel. So he told his chauffeur, come out. You sit at the back, I will drive. The chauffeur said, no, Your Holiness, this is not permissible. If I take over the wheel, I'll be fired from my job. He said, who will fire? I am the person to fire you. So don't worry. It's just for a little while. I just want to try. And so the chauffeur sat at the back of the limousine and the Pope took over. And soon he, like any German, he put his foot on the accelerator and shot off. Soon the cops were, the sirens behind him. And they stopped the limousine. When the officer came and saw the Pope, he immediately called his boss. He said, Chief, there's a very big guy I've caught here. He says, who is it? Is it the sheriff? No, he's bigger than that. What, he's the prime minister? No, he's bigger than that. He's the president? No, bigger than that. Who could be bigger than that? Cop says, is God traveling here? He says, what do you mean God traveling here? He says, yes, because the Pope is his chauffeur. I must tell you that we should never take life seriously. We take it too seriously. And one of the big advantages of being on a spiritual path is that you can have the right idea what this life is all about. It's just a journey that we have made into a new kind of experience for a temporary period. It's a journey that we should be enjoying. No matter how many ups and downs, we created the ups and downs to have thrill out of the journey. It's an adventure. Our own true nature, our own soul and our spirit is made out of a sense of humor. It's playful. That's why I said the word moj has been used consistently. That it is a moj of the Creator that this world came into being. And moj means playful will. We have merged when we have fun. So he did not create the world, nor did we as part of him create this world to have suffering. Suffering was created only as a means of temporary experience so we can enjoy something other than suffering. It was an opposite created so we could appreciate our own true state. That we created an artificial state in a dreamlike state. So when we wake up, we appreciate how beautiful the wakeful state is. So we have not come here just to get trapped into this and just think this is the only world we have, this is the only place and we are miserable people living here. That's not true. Of course we think so, it is true, because we have no awareness of our own true nature. And the spiritual path and our spiritual practices help us to get out of it. And we are able to go back to our true home and have such appreciation of our true home that there is nothing like it. But we can't say that unless we see something different from it. And that's why we are here, to see these different things here. And we'll go back home. We made these arrangements for ourselves that we will have this experience. And to make the experience last longer, there was nothing called longer there in our true home. To make the experience last longer, we put it in a time frame and we are now here and creating a past, present and future and living in it. This is very interesting that we created time only as an experience. It does not exist. Even today it does not exist. Even here it does not exist. We are all experiencing it. So that's the remarkable way that consciousness has been able to create such remarkable experiences, which we should sit and appreciate. If you really know where you belong, which is your true home, and you come to see something which you created as something new, you would admire the art. And this art is being reflected and reflected over and over again to enhance its effect and beauty. Once upon a time, there was a Chinese king. And the Japanese and the Chinese artists used to compete with each other. They used to say, we are better wall artists. You know, they did big paintings on the walls. And they competed with each other. The king held a competition between the Chinese and the Japanese. And he gave one wall of the hall to the Chinese and the opposite wall of the hall to the Japanese. And he put a curtain in the middle so that they should not see each other. So the Chinese went meticulously. All the artists began to paint and beautiful colors they used. And it was so beautiful, the king would from time to time come and see the progress of the work. They've given a month to complete their painting. The Chinese kept working very hard, day and night, making beautiful, colorful pictures. And the other side, they kept on polishing the wall. They did nothing. King said, when will they start? They're just polishing the wall, preparing it. Where the Chinese had almost completed. When the final day came, the Japanese had only polished the wall. And when the king saw the Chinese, they're beautiful, wonderful. He said, Japanese, show yours. They removed the curtain. The whole reflection of that fell into the and looked even better than the Chinese. And the Japanese won. By reflection, by copying, by not even working, but creating an image, creating a mirror for what had been done by the Chinese. This world is a copy, is a reflection of another world that lies inside us. It's not made really as it is. The real thing has been made inside. And by operating through sense perceptions in physical bodies, we see it outside. Everything you are seeing outside is also inside. It is the inside, the packed program inside, that's projecting this experience outside. When you go inside, you'll find out that the reality of this experience outside is lying inside. Everything that you're seeing outside is also inside. One mystic says, Bahar bhitar eko jano, yehi guru gyan bataya. He said, all I learned from my master was that the outer and the inner are the same. And we were so much wondering, oh, we have to leave the outer and go into the inner, and the whole spiritual path was being explained as if we are really somewhere out and now we have to really find some place somewhere else. There is no real out. It's all a reflection of what is inside. The truth even of what is outside lies inside. So when we go within and discover how our experiences are being created from consciousness, it's a very big discovery that the whole truth has always been lying inside us. And everything we see outside, and if we want to change anything, change from the source. You say, this was not the best life I could create. Go in and change it. You can do it. Here you can do nothing. How can you change reflection? If something is being reflected somewhere, you can't change it. But if you go to the original, you can change it, and the reflection changes along with it. Well, supposing at night, we see a full moon shining in the sky. Beautiful light, full moon. And then there is a pool. And we look into the pool and we see the reflection of the moon there. And then we put a mirror. And the reflection of the pool can also be seen in the mirror. So we see the mirror and say, what a beautiful moon. We are not looking at the moon. We think it is. That's the only moon. We are looking only in the mirror. And then we move the mirror. Wow, the moon also moves. Moon never moved. Mirror moved and we say, moon is moving. Then we find out, after great discovery, this is just a mirror. Real moon is not there. Real moon is in the pool. And we make one step discovery and go to the pool. Say, oh, mirror was only a reflection. The real moon we have found out now. That's in the pool, in the water. And we stir the water. Moon can break into so many pieces. And then we stir and the dirt comes up. Moon had disappeared. It's gone away. Moon was always there where it was. We just see the reflection upon reflection. This world is being experienced by us exactly in the same way. The truth is still unchangeable. Totality of consciousness, our own true self, never change, never will. Immortal, center of everything. When it reflects through the mind, it creates time, space, changes, moves. When we go out further into the world, people are real, things are real, and we are just aspiring to get things, anxious to get things and make things out here. We are trying to collect things and collect people around us here without realizing this is just a reflection and a distorted reflection and a moving reflection of what is the truth within ourselves, which is completely still and completely beyond any of these things. But yet, what a wonderful device that we can create mirrors and pools and moon and reflection upon reflection and create a variety of experiences from one still being called totality of consciousness, the creator. The creator can have such a large amount of designing and so much to be done just by the process of reflection should make us sit in wonder. If you have experience even of one level of seeing where the reflection is taking place, you will sit in awe and wonder. How can this happen? How wonderful it is to be able to create this thing. Now this is one way of looking at the world, to be in wonder and watch the drama, how we have been able to create all this. The second is, oh, we are trapped, I am suffering, I have got headaches and I don't know how to pay my bills. There is a way of, the two things are not inconsistent. You can still act that you have to pay your bills and you have to have headaches and illness and you have to go to the doctor. All those things are okay. But there's just an act going on so that we can live out what we prepared, live out the play we prepared. And therefore, true knowledge, true awareness is to get to know how the whole system is operating, the system of creation, how it's operating. And to see the whole system of operation, the only point of view where you can see the whole system operating is from the point of view of the creator. Not any small part of a creation, you can never see the whole part. If you are part of creation and think you are there, you cannot see everything. You can see very little. But if you withdraw yourself to the position where the creator is, you can see the whole pattern of creation and enjoy the creation like the playful creator is doing. Because our own totality is our totality of consciousness and our creator. There is no difference between the creator and ourselves. The creator is our totality. People say, I am myself, I am looking for my higher self. That the higher self is separate. There is, on Lake Michigan, a small temple. It's called the Ganges. It was set up because one of the old governors of state of Michigan went to India and he visited the river Ganges and he visited some holy places there and he found some temples. He found one temple of Ramakrishna and he thought that was a beautiful thing. And he said, I don't have a river like Ganges in my state, but I have a lake. And I would like to make a temple there. So he started the temple. It's right on the bank of the lake. And Ganges. In that temple, I went and saw that temple. And there is a whole story of Ramakrishna and how he got tempted by the devil and all the stories, which are very similar to all stories of all these great mystics. How they went through a course of being tempted by devil, the negative power, then they had to defeat them and then they got enlightened. So the story is there. But in addition to that, there's a large painting, actually stained glass painting, showing a tree, beautiful tree with many branches. And there is a bird sitting at the bottom, struggling to go up the tree. Cannot fly, its wings are clipped and it tries to go from one branch to another. But there's another bird sitting right on top, singing in great joy. Beautiful. This bird at the bottom keeps on crying, I wish I was that bird who's having such a happy time sitting on top of this tree and I'm struggling. So there's a poem alongside telling this story, how this struggling bird is going from branch to branch. Oh, I wish I was that bird sitting on top and having a good time and I'm struggling here, I'm in great bad shape. But as the bird gradually moves up, and goes to the top, it finds it's the same bird. So no other bird, it's the same bird was sitting up there. It was just that bird whose reflection had come down, and when it went to the top, it found its own reality. Therefore, there were no two birds. We don't have a higher self and a lower self. We have only one self. The self never divided. The self continues to be one. The self is the same, whether the self in a dream state, the self in a wakeful state, the self in the astral plane, self in the causal plane, the self as totality of creation, the self as creator. It's the same self. Self never changes. Therefore, that is why they say the self is the only reality. The self being conscious has the power of consciousness and experiences, whatever it becomes conscious of. Therefore, what it experiences is creation. And the experiencer continues to be the self and the only reality. All experience is created by consciousness, including the experience of immortality, including the experience of Satchkhand or true home. They are created by the self. Therefore, if you want to know what the reality is, real reality, beyond anything, with no possibility of saying, no, I'm not sure of that, the only reality is self, which can be experienced by you at all times, even now. Do you know, if you look back, supposing everything can be made up around you, is there something that cannot be made up? It's the one that is saying everything can be made up. It's the self. It's your own conscious self knowing that you are there. What makes you say you exist? The very thing that makes you feel you exist, no matter in what form, no matter where, the fact you exist as a self, as a conscious being, one that can experience something, that's the only reality. So the experiencer is the only reality. And when we say realize yourself, realize the creator, go to God, it's the same thing. There's no difference in any of these statements. And we try to distinguish between them. As if God is sitting separately, we are sitting here. Somebody asked me once, can you see God? I said, never. I said, why not? He said, by the time you see God, you are God yourself. How will you see? You will realize that there was no distinction. It's God's experience. that made you a human being and brought you here is not an outside experience. It's an experience taking place within God, not outside. There is no such thing as outside. We create outside for an experience only. So that is why the truth is very different from what we assume it is. There is no separation in reality. The real thing is totally non-separate. It's one. But we create separation for the sake of experience. And we shouldn't criticize such a great, grand creation to be experienced by us. I don't even criticize the mind that comes in the way of our meditation, comes in the way of our discovery of who we are. I appreciate it. I appreciate it doing a good job. Supposing I were to put a guard outside my house to protect, and the guard protects me from anything, I can't criticize. Why do you protect me? The guard, we have put a mind as a servant of ours to work for us and to generate experiences and allow the experiences to become real, so we enjoy it. We gave a duty to the mind and doing it. And then we start criticizing the mind. Mind is terrible. Mind is doing this. Well, you gave a duty to the mind. It's just performing duty as efficiently, as dutifully as it could. Therefore, you can have a different perspective on all these things. You can totally change your perspective on all these things. The higher you rise in your awareness, the more you know about yourself, the more your perspective will change. At the top, you will be smiling and enjoying and remain in a state of intoxication that will never leave you, because you will be able to watch the whole show from all points of view. As I said earlier on day one, that we have at one time experience of only one reality. At this time, when we are sitting here in the wakeful state, only the wakeful world, physical world around us looks real. And it's the only reality for us. Everything else is either imaginary or somewhere in our ideas or somewhere we can't see. We can't even see where the dream world is. I was surprised to find a large number of scientists today are trying to work out whether dreamland into which we go is actually land existing. They don't think that it's just in our head that we are creating those different scenes. They say people are creating such dreams. There may be a dreamland somewhere where we actually make a trip and go there and come back. But we can have no access to dream while we are away. It's a dream. It's just an idea. It's just something we created. So at one time we have one reality. When you go to the next plane of awakening, you become unaware of this plane. And that alone becomes reality. Physical world disappears. And for you, the astral world, the ethereal world is the only world exists, which is so different from here. And so wonderful. Compared to this one, it's really wonderful. The experience there are amazing, provided you stay on the right side of that world. There's a left side also, where all the hells and other things exist also. And that, by the way, I must intervene at this time to tell you that do not meditate without any guidance, because you can have negative experiences also at the astral state, particularly at the overlap of the astral and physical. There are a lot of negative experiences existing. And if one goes unguided, without help, you can get into trouble. So therefore, I always advise people, yes, you can meditate yourself, but you don't know where to go. Let somebody tell you where to stay, where to get the best experiences, and not to get into, unless you are interested in going to hell. Some people are. Some people are so interested, they make this life itself hell. We had a BB, very devoted BB. You understand what BB means? BB means a young lady. Any lady means a BB in India. And in the Dera, in Great Master's time, there were three young girls who came and became his disciples and stayed in the Dera to serve him forever. Of course, it created a lot of scandal also, that this old man retiring from his job has got all these young girls around him, and newspapers carried this scandal about him. But he didn't care about what people were thinking. He told them that you are going to serve and you will be doing meditation, and gave them instructions. They wanted to serve him personally. So, being women, they all wanted to grab the great master to themselves, each one. It's natural, you know. So, they used to fight with each other. There was one short one. I'm telling you some old story, sir, but true story. There was a short BB. There was a taller one, little thin. There was one stout one. The stout one was the most muscular. So when they tried to grab the different duties they could do to take care of the great master, the stout one, the one with the muscle, was able to push the other two out. And she sat in great master's house and she took care of him for 40 years, most of his life, since they came in. Most of his life, nearly 40 years, she served. Her name was Bibi Lajo. Then there was the second one who was tall, thin, not as strong as the first one, but stronger than the short one. So she pushed the short one out and took charge of the kitchen where the food was being cooked. The third one, being pushed out by both of them, went into the common kitchen, the langar of the era, and began to cook chapatis and make food there for everybody. The taller one in the kitchen was making food for great master, and the stout one was in the house taking care of him, of his wardrobe and kitchen and bath and all that. When the tall one with the kitchen, whose name was Bibi Rali, and the one who was pushed out, whose name was Bibi Rakhi. So they were Lajo, Rali and Rakhi. So when Rakhi would make chapatis for everybody, she would sing songs and remember the master. Every morning at 3 o'clock, the master would wake up and move around to go and help the people to get up and do meditation. He'd specially go and visit her. She got more time, real quality time with the master than the other two who were fighting to be close to him. So the one who was pushed out got the best deal out of all of them. The tall one who was making, Rali, who was making the food in the kitchen, she'd bring the food, at least I can serve the master food. When she brought from the kitchen up to the door where the great master's house was, the Lajo was standing there. That's my territory now. Here's the food. She would take it. I'm telling you, one doesn't realize one has different picture of the life of masters. But I'm telling you a true story. I'm talking great masters, right? That here he is being served. They're all doing very good dedications, loving seva, devotion. There's no question that they were all full of love and devotion in what they were doing. But the mind tendency to fight with each other, to be possessive, was not gone. It doesn't go away so easily. So while they were doing all this, the best experiences, spiritual experiences they had, was by Bibi Rakhi, who was outside. The next best was with the one who had the kitchen. And Lajo, of course, had also spiritual experiences, would go to, had the radiant form of the master all the time and would talk and very, very assertive. All of them had great experiences too. But the one who was the outside one, Rakhi, short one, she had the most amazing experiences. And I'm going to tell you a couple of her experiences. Because she, her house in the Dera was next to where our house was. We had been given a house also. Right next door she lived. So we met every day. I learned many things from her as a child. She was the first one. I was this young, and I got initiated like this little girl sitting here, 9 years old. And I used to be taught how to fly in the sky night by Bibi Rakhi. She told me how you can fly. So that was great experiences for me as a child. One day she was crying and screaming in her house. And we all got worried. People came out because we'd hear the screaming. And we knocked open her door. We broke the door open because she was very different from everybody else. And she was screaming. And we didn't know why she's screaming. We tried to stop her, hold her. Is she in hysterical state? What has happened to her? And we went and called the great master from his house. He came running quickly. And he said, Bibi, where are you? She said, I am in hell. What hell are you in? And she described the hell where souls in their astral bodies, non-physical bodies were being tortured and being burnt, and she gave a full description of so much horror going on there. And great master said, is anybody hurting you? She said, nobody is hurting me. Then why are you crying? I am crying because I can't afford to see what is going on here. He said, then come out. I don't know how to come out. Say this, repeat your simran, repeat the holy words I gave you. I have forgotten them. In this hell, I have forgotten even the words. He said, can you hear my voice? Yes, I can hear your voice. Then follow my voice and come out. And after that, she opened her eyes, put her head on his feet and said, that was a terrible experience. He said, who told you to go to hell? Just out of curiosity. They really say curiosity kills the cat. So I am only saying, even a woman who was initiated, it developed, who could have experiences inside, could go make a mistake of just saying, I am curious to see, is there a real hell? And just went, goes in and has that horrible experience. Another time, the same Bibi Rakhi, once she was locked up in the house and she didn't come out. Normally she would always come out in the morning and we would see her going, and she didn't come out. 2 days she didn't come out. So we said maybe she died or passed inside the house. So we again broke open her door and was sitting in meditation in an upright posture with her feet crossed, and we saw there were ants crawling and eating up her heel, because she had, when she walked into the house, stepped on a piece of good, or some jaggery, they use that brown sugar in India. And somehow one piece was lying and she just stepped on it and they stuck to her heel. And she was meditation so long that they had eaten up not only the jaggery, they were eating up the heel. So we said, it's a terrible state. So we, and she was not talking to anybody, not walking, but she was still sitting still like that. And we called the great master. Master, Bibi is in some kind of trouble. We see she opened a door. She was not out for 2 days. And look at her foot. He came running. And he looked at her. He said, call Dr. Shakuntala. Now I should tell you who is Dr. Shakuntala. Dr. Shakuntala was also a medical doctor in Kapurthala state. And she did not believe in spirituality. She says, I am a scientist. I am a doctor. I believe in what evidence exists, that all these things that you're talking about can be created by the brain. And when you talk of near-death experiences, just lack of oxygen, she had all the explanations for all the experiences people were talking about. This is not real. It can be created in a physical body. So she said she loved Great Master because of his white beard. I also loved his beard. This morning somebody has sent me an email asking, how was his beard so white? Was he bleaching it? Or were the pictures made Photoshop? No, it was really white. So she loved him and his white beard, Dr. Shakuntala, but never believed in what he said. He said, no, this is not possible. The great master said, call Dr. Shakuntala. So a car was sent and the doctor came up from Kapurthala in about half an hour. And the great master said, doctor, look at the foot of this woman. Ants are eating it up. Half the heel has been eaten up. Look at this, it looks like a dead body. And he said, oh my God. She tried to remove that and put some kind of temporary bandage. She said, this should be removed immediately to a bigger hospital. This is not even good for your Dera hospital. She should be removed in Lahore and taken immediately to a big hospital. He said, but she is in a state of meditation. And doctor said, Master, I respect you. I like you. But this is no time for jokes. This is a serious medical condition. You have to take her to the hospital immediately. She is in a state of deep coma that she is not even knowing that her whole foot is being eaten up and she is unaware of it and is totally unconscious. So she is in deep coma. So great master said, when one is in deep coma, do they lose all their reflexes? Is there an effect on their vital forces, vital systems also? She said, of course, they are all affected. He said, will you check her? So Shakuntala checked her blood pressure, checked her pulse, checked her breathing, checked other vital signs, and she said the vital signs seem to be all right. Then what is the reflexes affected? She said, oh, they are also reflective to some extent. Okay, test that. She took out a hammer they carry and went to hit and to test all the reflexes. All were okay. Great Master said, Doctor, if all the vital signs of the body are okay, the reflexes are okay, and you say she is in a deep coma, how do you explain this? Doctor said, in my medical practice, such a case has never happened, and I can't explain it. It's out of my knowledge. It has to be taken to immediately specialist who will take care of it. And please don't waste time in this discussion and move the patient there. And Great Master said, I think, Doctor, she is in meditation and she is enjoying her travels in Khand Brahmand. And Doctor said, please, 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 no more jokes. This is not a case of Khand Brahmand that you're talking of. He said, but I'll ask her soon what she is doing. He said, how can you ask a person in such deep coma? And then Great Master said, Bibi, open your eyes. And Bibi opened her eyes. Tell us what was he. I was having such a great time. And I was floating around in all those places that she began to describe all the good experiences she was having. On that day, Dr. Shakuntala became Great Master disciple. She had to see this experience for herself. Because it was very difficult for her to believe unless a miraculous thing like that was shown to her. People say, what is the value of miracles? This was a miracle for Dr. Shakuntala. It was a miracle. For us, it was nothing. We knew she was in meditation. We knew meditation can go that deep that you are completely unaware of your body. You lose consciousness. And therefore, many things can happen. But that was just a demonstration for that doctor that medical science cannot explain everything. Medical science has not been able to explain what consciousness is. We had a VIP, a foreign dignitary, coming to India, and he had a car accident and went into a coma, into a real coma. And we tried to get best treatment. We called our best doctors from Bangalore, and those specialists in the brain surgeries and so on. We couldn't. Then we found one guy from overseas. And we called one from Venice and one from Montreal. And those people had done 1,000 brain surgeries. They knew all about the exact location of everything on the brain. So we brought one of them, and one man was checking out this nature of the coma and what level it is. There are several levels in which they can test out the coma in the brain. And there, my boss, who was the chief minister of the state, he asked, Doctor, tell me one thing. What is it that makes a person conscious and then can go into a coma and lose consciousness? What is consciousness? And the doctor turned to him and said, Sir, there is a question we have been asking ourselves for thousands of years and we haven't found the answer yet. What is consciousness? We have not found the answer. What happens to a body that is alive and suddenly dies? All the body parts, the organs are still the same. There is no change in them. Something stops suddenly. What is it that stops? If you say, there's one organ failure, organs fail, and they take care of it. Or nowadays, almost all organs can be replaced. There's an organ transplant available today. Today's science permits you to transplant all organs except the brain. That's the science has made that kind of steady progress. Science has also said that if we need and we want to increase longevity of life with today's technology, with organ transplant, we can extend the life of a human being to 300,000 years. If we all lived so long, a Gallup poll was held on this issue some years ago, that if we could make our life 100,000 years or 300,000 years, how many of you would like to live that long? 90% said no. We don't want to be bored with sitting here for 100,000 years. We are happy with 100, 200, maybe little more than that. The technology for maintaining body exists, but what is in the brain that holds life is consciousness. It's not a material thing that can be taken out and discovered. It is something that has not been found. And yet, it's the whole thing that gives us life. It's the whole thing that makes us move around and look and talk and do everything. Without that, we are nobody. Without that, there is no body. Without that, there is no world. It's only our awareness and consciousness that is creating all experiences. The main problem that has arisen because of our reality being outside is that we are looking at consciousness from a reality, from a shadow we are trying to find out. We are looking at a shadow and saying, the shadow being real, what casts this shadow must be final shadow. And instead of seeing it real, we are putting all attention on the shadow. That's why we can't find out. If we look from the other end, from the side of where does this body come from? Where does experience of consciousness come from? Where are all these sense perceptions working from? Which means we go to the other end, we get all the answers to these questions. And we have clear answer what life is. Life is consciousness. Consciousness is permanent. Consciousness is ourself. Then we get all the answers to all the questions. So it all depends from which side you are looking at it. Looking from the reality of this physical world, you can never find out what consciousness is. No way. Looking at the other end, you can know how the whole world is being created from consciousness. Therefore, the mystics have advised, you want to study and know, if you want true knowledge, go to that point from where you can see the whole thing. Then you will have true knowledge. And that's only from inside. When you go within your own self, your total self, the real self, all the questions are answered. You get complete description, a complete knowledge of every detail of how different levels of experiences are being created, how they become realities. And as I was telling, that when we are here, this physical reality is our only reality. When we go to the astral plane, the ethereal reality, the state where we don't have bodies like these, we have bodies. Those bodies move around. They are similar to these bodies. We can walk and we can fly. There is no gravity. They have lot of things. We communicate telepathically with each other. We have so much knowledge of things. We can pull out knowledge from a library, an astral library. Everything that you have here in its pure subtle form is there. From where it's being solidified into material dimensional work, world that we are seeing here. But that experience becomes the only reality. At that time, that's the only reality. We come to know that's real. The physical world was not. Then we come to physical world, this becomes real. Then what happens to that experience? Become like a very lucid dream, like a very strange, beautiful dream, more real than this particular dream. Why is it a dream? Because this is real. This is a problem that we only have hold on one reality at one time. Therefore, we cannot hold two, three realities. When we go to the causal plane, we discover the whole thing has been created from the mind. And there is a universal mind becoming individuated because of the experience below. And that is why the truth is that everything is being created from there. It was a projection from there. We find out all that. But then we find everything is unreal except that level. So we live in that thinking that's the only reality. We go higher up, discover our own soul and find out this, our own consciousness was the only reality. Everything was created outside of it, was being created for experience outside. And the soul is the only reality. So at one time, right up to that point, par brahm, what they say right from here, from the sthool physical state to the sukshma state of astral, to the karan state of causal, to the pure spiritual atma state of atma, all are only one reality at one time. When you transcend that and come to your true self, you discover all the realities were being created and all are illusions and all are realities at the same time. You get a full picture of what all is. That's the only point when all of them can be experienced once and all are real and all are unreal, and you can step into any while still staying in the other. And you can then continue to work anywhere you like in any level. perfect living masters are in that state. Gurmukhs who reach that state, disciples who reach that state are in that state, where they can experience all realities at the same time, all illusions at the same time. That is why when perfect living masters come here, they are able to see the whole thing. They don't see one part of it. They are not enlightened people who just once got enlightenment and are coming to teach us something. They are carrying that enlightenment, total enlightenment, with them when they are in physical bodies amongst us, sitting with us. They look like ordinary people, but their awareness is total at that time, even in the physical form. And that's what makes them most extraordinary, because they can give you answers to your questions about any level. They can guide you no matter where you are. They can also tell you where you are actually stationed while you're still thinking you are the body. All that system I'm talking of, that is levels of creation and levels of consciousness, is not unique to anybody. We all have it. There is nothing special inside a perfect living master that we all don't have. There's no special God sitting in him that we don't all have. We all have the same thing, all humanity, all human being, no matter where, having identical things. We all are equally qualified and equally equipped, equally endowed with everything. The only thing is, how much are we aware of it? How much have we blocked from our own awareness? And we have not blocked because somebody pushed us. We blocked ourselves for a unique experience called creation of reality. That's why we blocked it. Otherwise, the whole thing could be illusion. The whole thing can be made real. And when we make one real, it becomes absolutely real because nothing else is there to compare it with. So that is why I am giving you a broad picture. I must have taken it from a book, I think. Maybe a book called Manual of PLMs or something. Manual of Perfect Living Masters. I am telling you the big picture, that when you see, when we meet a perfect living master, who is he? What is he seeing? What is he looking at? Is he looking at just the person in front of him? He's just looking at the things around him? Or is he looking beyond that? He's looking at everything. He's looking at the total picture at all times. It's a very different experience. He's also looking that the one he's looking at is part of himself. He's looking that there's nobody outside, just a created image. He's aware of that and yet operates within that. Because the show must go on. This is the show. And this is the show of consciousness and of totality of consciousness. And that is why these perfect living masters, they need not say they are masters. They need not do anything to show they are masters. They are still masters. It's not saying or showing something that makes them. It's their awareness that makes them. And their awareness is total. And therefore, they are one with the playful one. They are one with the same. And therefore, they play games. I can never forget the big games great master used to play. I told you about how he played that surprise trick on Julian Johnson by hiding in that room. Who could imagine an old man with a white beard would be trying to play games like that with a visiting foreigner, an American? I mean, who would think like that? We say, no, no, he's a guest coming from there. We have to be on our best form and formal and so on. And he's thinking of playing games at that time. I can tell you that these masters play more games than we can realize. The very fact that they come as human beings amongst us is a game for them. And for they want to come and tell us, you are the same. You have the same capacity, the same power of awareness. You also go and join us in the game that we are playing. And make the whole world, make your life into a game. And play it like we are playing. Play it like our totality is playing. So they don't want you to be that serious. They don't want you to be serious in life. They don't want you to be serious even the meditational techniques. They don't say, be so serious and grum and serious. Oh, I am going to see God and therefore I have to be very serious. You should be very joyful, playful, dancing. That is why these people who get intoxicated, they dance and sing as a natural expression of their joy. When you are joyful, you don't make somber faces and become serious. You are always in a good state. It is well said that we have 8 senses, not 5. 5 senses of seeing, hearing, touching, tasting, smelling. These 5 senses, physical senses, create an experience for us. Almost all living forms have most of these senses and they are experiencing the world like we are doing it. These 5 senses make us just ordinary animal-like human beings. That's why we are human animals with these 5 senses. What differentiates us? That we also have a 6th sense. 6th sense, intuition. If you only had 5 senses, you would have no intuition. Your life would be very animal-like. But you are above it. Because the gut feeling gives you information and knowledge which you can't get with the 5 senses. I personally think the 6th sense is more important than the 5 senses in deciding what kind of species are we? What type of human beings are we? The 6th sense distinguishes us from the other animals. The 7th sense is even more important, according to me. And that is common sense. Very uncommon, but still common sense. What is common sense? Common sense is to be able to distinguish between the grain and the chaff. To be able to distinguish what is important, what is not. Common sense is that which lays down your priorities in life. When we have priorities on the wrong things, we lack common sense. When we can say, no, this is more important than this, I should realize this is more important, you are applying your common sense. Common sense sets the pattern of your life. Therefore, common sense is even more important than the other 6 senses. But the 8th sense, according to me, is the highest sense. And that is the sense of humor. The ability to laugh. The ability to look at things from the point of view is my entertainment and amusement. To be amused. To be able to laugh at things. To be able to laugh at yourself. To be able to laugh at the show. And to be internally laughing at even things that don't look worth laughing at. To see how this whole show has been placed. How this world has been created. How these different situations have been created. How the law of karma is operating. Why say, I am bound down by my bad karma? No, rise above and say, how does karma operate? Let's see the working of it. And the whole perspective changes. Rise to that level of awareness where you can enjoy the humor in things. There's so much humor in the very creation. I can assure you, if God, the creator, is someone separate from us, which I don't believe is, if he's someone separate, he's smiling all the time at what is going on. He's smiling, first of all, at how seriously we are taking life. He's smiling, I set up a show, and what do they take it like? It's not real, and they are taking it as absolutely real. A very amusing thing. And when I say, you are that, then you should be in that attitude of being able to see the show from the point of view of an audience. Become an audience. Seat yourself at a place right where you are now. Because to see this world as a show, you have to put yourself separately as a spectator, that you are witnessing this show and you are not part of the show. How can you do that when you are part of the show? When you think the body is yourself, you are part of the show. So first step in trying to see this world as a show is not to treat your body as yourself. Treat yourself as consciousness, the one that is witnessing the whole thing. No matter if you happen to be in one of the bodies. It's just a plan. It's just a plan that you are in one body. It is a design that you should be in one body, so the act becomes real. It's interactive. It's an interactive show. To make it interactive, you have been placed in one body. So you sit in the body. But it doesn't matter if you're sitting in a body. Doesn't mean you become the body. You sit in the body and operate and watch. The point where you can sit and watch the show and be an audience and actually enjoy the show is the point where consciousness sits. So that's your real self. Your awareness sits from where you become aware of what's going on, which is the point in the head, behind the eyes. If you are able to sit yourself there, not once for meditation, but all the time you are there. You are in a body of one of the characters and you are watching the show from there. You are sitting in a relaxed way, in a chair. This body is running. This body is doing various things. It's just one character doing it. You are not moving. You are relaxed. You are watching this from the show. And all other people around you are also acting. This also one is acting. And you are sitting in the audience, in the chair, in your relaxed state, behind the eyes. Whole world becomes a show. Why should that be difficult? Going to astral or causal stages may be difficult. But to be able to have a different perspective on what is going on around you should not be difficult, because it requires a simple exercise. Which exercise is the most important exercise for going to any higher stages also? The exercise of continuously being aware. You are not this body. You are using the body. You are using it to witness the show. You are sitting inside, watching the show from inside, and knowing that you are surrounded by a body, and watching inside, opening your eyes, opening your sense perceptions, and seeing the show outside. That should not be difficult to do. And that's a good starting point. If you do just that, your life will change from now. In one instant life, people say, can you get instant knowledge? Yes. This is the one in which you can get instant knowledge. Just move your attention from being the body, from being the physical self, into one who sits in the body. And the body is one character, body is one vehicle, one is one carriage you are carrying. You are in a moving thing and you move without moving yourself. You only drive your vehicle. You drive your vehicle and watch the show all around it. Just do that much and you will have the first stage of instant knowledge. And if you sit there long enough, you get second and third stages also. The secret is to withdraw your attention to third eye center behind the eyes. If I have been able to convey this message to you, only this much, I think I have been very successful in having this Bhandara with you. The simple message that don't waste time outside. These are temporary. Don't try to grab this and grab that and look for this and look for that. They are not going to go with you at all. It's too shadowy, too temporary thing. Look back on your life. How much have we tried to grab? I want to collect this item. I want to collect that item. I am going to make plans for getting this. How many goods have we collected? How much clutter have we put inside the houses and inside our head? How much clutter we collect during our life? How many relationships we are trying to make? How many things we are trying to make our own? How many people we are trying to make our own and none of them are our own? The moment we die, everything is gone. Nothing is ever gone with us. They tell the story of Alexander the Great, that when he came to the East and came to India, he invaded India with his army and he looted all the temples. There were a lot of gold there and he had his own large caravan of horses and camels and elephants, and he loaded all those with all the wealth he collected, and he killed so many people, orphaned so many children, made so many women widows in the fights that he carried on. I'm Alexander the Great. And on his way back, as you might know from history, he died on the way. And when he was dying on the way, it was in the desert that he was dying. Before he could reach his own capital in Egypt, when he was dying on the way, he told his doctors, I have so much fever, I can't sit on the horse, I can't lie down, I can't sit up. Can you do something? They said, Alexander, your last day has come. We cannot help you. There is nothing that can survive. You are in a terminal stage to die. He says, I'll give all the wealth I've collected. If somebody can give me just a few days so I can reach Egypt, I can reach Alexandria, which is named after it later on. If I can reach that point, I'll give all my wealth away. Sorry, your death is imminent. There's no way we can take you back home. He said, but I know I cannot die because a gypsy told me when I was very young, Alexander, you are born to conquer the world and you will not die unless the sky turns into gold and the earth turns into silver. You will not die. He said, that will never happen. How can I die? But because he was so sick, there was nothing to put on the ground. He had a silver armor which they was carrying. They laid out a silver armor, put him on that, There was a canopy made of gold. They put him on top, and he saw gold on top, silver at the bottom. He knew his end had come. And then he said, now I know the gypsy was right. My sky has become gold, and my earth has become silver. I know I'm going. But I have killed so many people. I have caused so much torture to collect wealth that can't go with me now. Then he ordered that when they put him in a coffin, they should leave his hand outside the coffin. So the whole world should know. Even Alexander the Grand went empty-handed when he died. A great message. We all go empty-handed when we die. Nothing that we collect here ever goes with us. And imagine how much attention and time we are giving to collecting things and collecting people and trying to make relationships here. Whereas the only thing that will go is something that is inside us which does not die. Why not make relationship with that? The beauty of this spiritual path is you can find something outside that can also go inside. A friend outside who can also be friend inside and forever, who does not die. Along with the death of your bodies, the body of the friend and your body and still is there, your friend. And such a person we call a perfect living master. A perfect living master presents himself in this world to us as one of those friends who will not die and not be left behind, but will stay with us even when we die. So that is why it's a very great opportunity for us to seek insight so we can be found by perfect living master. And when that opportunity comes, question, remove your doubts, ask more questions, carry on till the unconditional love of that person becomes visible to you and pulls you in a way that nothing else has done before. If that happens, then you know there's something else. It is not a contact with my body, it's not a contact with my senses, not a contact with my mind, not a contact with my thoughts that is pulling me. Something else is pulling, something that I have not been aware of. My soul is a soul-to-soul connection. Our connection with the Master is soul-to-soul. It's not a connection body-to-body or mind-to-mind or thoughts-to-thought. It's a connection of soul-to-soul that overrides any objection that the mind is raising. It overrides any difference in the bodies that we have. It overrides any differences in the perceptions we have. It overrides our ideas. It overrides everything. That connection of soul to soul overrides everything. And that is the connection. When we come across such masters, they touch our soul. We don't know what it is. We never experienced our soul. We were just outside of the soul, continuously experiencing other things. And they come and touch our soul. Something happens inside. We don't know where it is happening. But something is happening to us, pulling us, and the mind can't understand it, and the mind is trying to fight it. Yet something is pulling us. That's because their connection with us of the soul, they are not bothered about how we are living, who we are, what our religion is, what our belief system is, what we think about, what we eat, what we do, anything. They are not connected with that. This is normal. Everybody has soul to soul. This soul is ready to go back home. And I have been mandated by totality to take this soul back with me to that totality. This is my role now in this form. And the master takes that soul back home. It's a very simple proposition, really, for a master to say, I've come here only to take your soul back home where it belongs. Rest is all left here. Everything is left here. Not only worldly things are left here, we leave even all the astral world here. We leave all our sense perceptions here. We leave even our minds and thoughts here. They don't go with us. We just go pure soul, consciousness with consciousness, and merge and become totality of consciousness. That's the simple synopsis of what I'm trying to convey to you. I hope your visit here will be beneficial, and I hope you will be triggered into looking for yourself inside. Those who are already initiated by perfect living masters, I hope this opportunity will give you fresh impetus. Let's now meditate. We have spent a lot of time in just wasting outside. Let's now try to have it inside. If that happens, this Bhandara and this meeting has been successful. I wish you all Godspeed. I wish you all great pastoral blessings. God bless you.